Good morning, afternoon, and evening. You are listening to the Liberal Artists Podcast. My name is Andy Gibby Gibson, filling in as host for one Bodio, who is busy being a grown-ass adult and having responsibilities. And joining me here today are my good friend Kaylie Horowitz.
Hello, love.
Oh, we've got a British version. I wonder why. And our special guest star and master of outros, one Ian Downs.
A pleasant evening to you.
Oh my gosh, I feel like I'm back in 11th grade theater class all of a sudden. How exciting, but
return
I'll hold
guest
together.
Represent.
She dragged him along when we realized Bo wouldn't be able to be here and was just like, hey, you get over here. See this microphone?
You live in this house too. You've got to contribute to our dumb podcast.
Ian's kind of like, Ian's kind of like the urban legend of, you know how at Disneyland, Aladdin has to be ready to kill somebody if he needs to. Like, I don't think that's real.
Stupid Tumblr post.
That's
so
in my
much.
Clause as well, though. It is in my clause as well. I have to be ready to kill something.
But like, what do you have at the ready to do that with? Like Aladdin, they give him like the curved sword or something like that. What's your go to?
Got a stick.
Okay.
There's also a weight.
Oh, that's true. I've stubbed my toe on that dumbbell that you keep by your desk too many times at this point.
For purposes of recording, it's nice to be the one who's finally calling somebody else out for podcasts being a visual medium. Like, I understand the weight of the host now, where Ian just showed something to the camera and there's no way the audience could know anything.
You'll
about
never
it.
Know.
It's a little bit of theater of the mind, which is something Ooh. That I know that is very, very important to all aspects, but especially important to the newest version of Sweeney Todd, as I've been told.
Oh, wow. Oh, man, we're rocketing into this. Like, the weight of responsibility upon Bo's shoulders is weighing heavy on me right now.
Yeah, you got some big shoes to fill, my friend.
I was going to say something about how I just bought a ticket to you guys' wedding.
Wow.
So I'm excited about that. But screw it all. We've got Sweeney Todd to talk about, baby.
No time for weddings and travel and airport stories. We're jumping right into the heart of this. Unless there's something that you do want a tangent on, Ian.
I think you'll have so much time to talk about this wedding when you have your Blast from the Past episode where you're all in the same room and it's
Excellent,
the worst
good.
Recording
Whoa,
of all time.
We could
you don't
do
actually...
that. That could yes. be really funny or really
However,
bad.
Ian is absolutely correct that it would be the worst of all time. Do you want to know why that is?
Because we'd all be drunk.
Well,
Gibby wouldn't.
No, that's true. You wouldn't be.
I wouldn't be, but I'd be feeding off the energy.
Yeah, like.
But would you be able to tell?
I was to say the like infectious, silly goose nature will come for you one way or another.
Yeah, like the silly goose will get to me and mm-hmm. I will join the gander because I recall one episode we did in January where I was at Bo's apartment. And I did not realize this at the time. I recorded into the wrong side of my microphone. I held it backwards.
That's good. It's good.
Yeah, it's very good technique, you know? So really, I think it's truly just like a wonder what would happen if you put three of us collectively. It's like the dumbest triforce of all time.
It really is.
And that power, it's just too much to wield.
There is only... 2.5 brain cells, and usually Bo has the two. Gibby and I have to split the half.
We're like the dumbest electrons coming around a neutron, just saying the dumbest shit while we circle him. But we'll cross that stupid bridge when we get there. Let's talk about Sweeney Todd.
Woo!
The tender, tender, tender,
attend the tale of Sweeney Todd.
So, in case any of our listeners weren't 17-year-old theater snobs at one point in time, Sweeney Todd is basically, at one point, Melodrama the Musical, and at like another point in time, Emo the Musical, which you could see how that might appeal to a group of socially questionable 17-year-olds. It's based on was it a dime novel or
Penny Dreadful?
Penny Dreadful, yes. From the
can we get Penny Dreadfuls while we're out? We have Penny Dreadfuls at home. Dime novels,
yes. Pulp character from the 1800s, I believe.
If I remember, and I did a little bit of research previously, the original series, like this Penny Dreadful series, was published in 1846, but it was being written originally like as the like installments earlier. Like it was 1846 to 1847 is what Wikipedia says are its its periodical issues.
Is that what it says on the Wikipedia article?
But if
reading the same article, it says that the stories of the String of Pearls was published in a weekly magazine during the winter of 1846 to 1847.
Yeah.
Yes. But regardless,
but basically, yeah, like there are stories and accounts that the Penny Dreadful was based on that come from the late 1700s to the early 1820s, roughly. Mm. And then, 20 years later, I do love how Wikipedia says, who's the author? Unknown, but probably James Malcolm Rymer and or Thomas Becket Prest. Like, I think that is so funny that we don't have confirmation on who wrote String of Pearls.
But regardless, Sweeney Todd is the demon barber of Fleet Street. Watch out. He'll get you with that razor. And remind me, in the original tales and everything, was he like just a horror sort of character?
Pretty
or
much.
Like an avenging guy?
No,
like...
he was already a little off his rocker when we're first introduced to him.
Who among us isn't a little?
In the String of Pearls, Penny Dreadfuls, we're introduced to him already as he and Lovett are working in their operation already. Like, there's no, I'm just a sad, mistreated young man, bitter against the world, and I seek vengeance. My man's is just already killing for money and bloodlust a little bit, perhaps. Although he does seem like he wants to get out of it, but it's not necessarily a, like, I have a tragic backstory. Ah!
Was it at that point in the story that there was just a light fare of cannibalism going on as well? Was that from like day one, or was that just
pretty
later
much
on? Like, ooh, tasty.
Like, yes. The way that String of Pearls is written, we're basically following Sweeney Todd in his, you know, murder spree. I feel like it's not really a spoiler to say that, yeah, like he's the demon barber of Fleet Street. There are some men that go into his barbershop, tonsorial parlor, that don't come back out. And wow, isn't it convenient to live right above a meat pie shop and work with the woman running the shop, and she'll bake the bodies into pies. And apparently they're really tasty.
Oh my gosh, spoiler alert.
I mean,
I've only had since 1846 to read this, Kaylie.
Basically, like, we're seeing what's happening from Sweeney's perspective as he's already working in this plot with Mrs. Lovett. At the same time, a sailor has come home from sea. He's coming to find his girl that he has a string of pearls for as a gift. It's a priceless gift, like 300,000 pounds worth of pearls. And Todd, he comes into Todd's parlor. Todd kills him and realizes, oh shit, there's these expensive pearls. I could pawn these off and get the hell out of Dodge and be done with all of this. But Sailor Boy has a dog. The dog doesn't leave his side. And so, like, Joanna is also sort of like, hey, where's my guy? He was supposed to be here. The sailors that he came, like, to port with are like, hey, this dog keeps hanging around the parlor. That's kind of weird, but we've got no idea where our buddy is. All the while, Todd, like, they're looking for the sailor. In the meantime, Todd is trying to figure out, how do I get rid of these pearls and get out of London without getting caught?
Eat the pearls. You should eat the pearls.
And Toby has his own, like, he's already working for Mrs. Lovett and Todd, and he's
random street boy for audience knowledge.
Beaten and abused and neglected. But apparently in String of Pearls, him and Joanna actually, like, get sent off to the Fog's Asylum together and have a, like, really dramatic escape that I'm like, why did we get why was this part of it cut from the musical?
Because they're friends in the musical. In the music, like, it doesn't make sense at all if you transcribe it.
But yeah, so there's lots of those kind of pieces of characters all connected, but multiple things happening across, like, basically 2 to 3 different stories. And it works really well when you're serializing it as a Penny Dreadful, because you get to do all these little snippety installments and see what happens. Is someone going to get caught? Is someone going to find out? Like, it's a great formula in that regard.
Like, outside of the cholera and everything awful about living in the 1840s, it would have been pretty sweet to be a Penny Dreadful writer, because it's just like, all right, in 6 months, I got to deliver 500 words, and then I'll do it again in another 6 months.
Come on, baby, you got to get paid by the word.
We really missed out on our opportunity to be 1840 Penny Dreadful salesmen and writers.
I feel as though one of the problems, though, is if you've got to have the education and the typewriter, though.
That is true.
Two things which are rather expensive, even in our current modern moment.
100 years later, Stephen Sondheim was just like, hey, you know that story about, like, a murderer, barber, and, like, eating people and everything? Let's make a musical out of that.
Put that shit on the West End. Let's go.
Swing your razor wide, swinging, hold it to the skies. Freely flows the blood of those who die.
But Mr. Sondheim, I don't know if anybody knows what you're talking about.
Shut up. Just do it. I promise it will work.
I made Romeo and Juliet good. You can't say
shit
to me.
I mean, honest to God, at a certain point in Stephen Sondheim's library, you can tell, like, I love Sondheim as I'm not a musical theater scholar. I don't understand nearly enough about music composition or theory. But all the gut feeling I have to go on is Sondheim was the, like, creme de la creme, like, peak musical theater kid, can create something beautiful and inspiring and resonates with so many people. But the second you leave them alone for 5 minutes, they become so unhinged.
Oh, absolutely.
And, like, you can see that in his body of work, I think.
We left Stephen Sondheim alone for 5 minutes, and he made John Wilkes Booth and Charles Guiteau and Squeaky Fromm into his main characters.
We left this man alone for 5 minutes, and he wrote a musical about assassins that shot presidents. You leave him alone for 10 minutes, and he'll give you 2 acts about a demon barber.
It's kind of like that SpongeBob clip of him watching the flower, where if he like takes his eye off of it for a second.
Oh, yeah, 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 with Mystery the Seahorse.
Precisely. Anyways, that one stars Len Carew, and it stars Angela Lansbury.
Based.
And it's fucking melodramatic.
It is.
Like, Ian, have you listened to that recording recently?
The original Angela Lansbury sort of recording?
This was the original, I believe, on both the West End and Broadway. Like, it was pretty much all the same cast that transferred from one to the other.
It's been a while, but I remember the set rather specifically because of the way that they specifically keep everything in its own little box on top of itself. And everybody after them went, that's great. We'll just do
boxes.
That. That's a good idea. I love boxes.
Because we're getting the cramped feeling of industrial London. And we'll never improve from there. And we'll never do it any different.
Which I will say, like, I think a lot of people always underestimate how much this show is. Like, we could talk about, I was just in a production of it over the summer.
Yeah.
And even I'm sitting there like, oh, yeah, no, I know this is technically, like, from a music standpoint, this is one of Sondheim's most challenging musicals. Like, not only do you have so much patter and so many split harmonies and all of these things going on with your ensemble, but also when the hell do you breathe? You have to figure out how to put blood on stage. You have to figure out how to make a barber chair that slides victims down a weird meat chute. And then you also forget that you are traveling across so many different places in London. Like, there was an immersive-ish production a couple years ago that staged Sweeney Todd in a pie shop. And I'm like, that's really cool. What about the rest of the show? You have to go to an asylum.
Who's to say that an asylum doesn't have a pie shop in it?
Yeah.
I've been to at least two asylums, and both of which I could have bought a pie at if I really wanted to.
All farm to table, baby. All organic.
No! Well, okay, let's be fair, though. Would you rather have a pie shop that has an asylum, like, attached to it, like a separate wing, or would you rather have the asylum with, like, a pie shop as part of the cafeteria?
An asylum with a pie shop as part of a cafeteria is just a normal occurrence. Insane asylums for the longest time had people working in their bakeries as staff. Like, these are
sure.
Fully, I
but
could
like
talk
a
about
pie
asylums.
Shop?
We can have a chat, but yeah, but a pie shop. These asylums for the longest of time, especially in Europe, were places where people with mental disabilities were put, often not even with disabilities, just differences were put.
Yeah.
To generate labor for a market that could then extort them and use their bodies for pay. And one of the best ways to do that, honestly, is by baking pies. Because you know who can bake pies? Anyone. Anyone can cook.
Thanks, Chef Gusteau.
You haven't seen my pies. There were attempts that were made, but they weren't made very well.
Wait, like fruit pie or meat pie?
Like fruit pie.
Oh, okay.
But have you been locked in an asylum for 2 years with the sole idea that that is what you're going to be doing as your job now? Like, that's the cutting point. You've got to be ready to do that.
Let me tell you about my summer abroad in London.
That's me. You're probably wondering how I got into this situation. Let me tell you.
Why did I have to pay for this? I could have just done this for free. Yeah. This, like I was saying, is an extremely melodramatic, like, recording and, like, production of it. You can see it on DVD. You can probably see a ton of it online by this point. But I listened through the cast album of it on Spotify. And let me just tell you, everybody is so full of feelings.
Oh, absolutely.
In this version. I feel like they play up the melodrama to, like, the maximum. Do you know those clips of Mel Blanc when he, like, shakes the recording booth because he's screaming too loud as Bugs Bunny?
Yes!
That's what it feels like when Len Carew plays Sweeney, except during, like, the quieter songs here or there. Just, like,
these
listening to this man.
My friends.
Listening to him during Epiphany when he's just,
oh my,
like,
God.
We all deserve
to
die.
Yeah, no, like, Led goes off on that song. It's terrifying in a really cool way, but it's terrifying.
Yeah. The poor, like, audio engineer behind the glass was probably just like, am I safe? Am I okay right
Can
now?
He get through this? Am I gonna die?
Sorry, can we pause for a second? Len, you have a knife. Can you not? Can you
put
not? He's breaking through
down.
The glass.
He's carving a hole in the glass.
I was gonna say he's
Scooby-Doo
doing the
style.
Like spy and movie, ooh. Cutting a hole in the glass with the barber's razor.
Oh, precisely. And like I wanna say for everybody who's only familiar with Angela Lansbury because of Murder, She Wrote, you need to listen to her songs at least, because she is so fantastically batty in
oh,
this.
Yeah.
Like she was absolutely perfect for this role. Like when she's just like, oh, by the way, we got a dead guy.
Right.
Let's put him in a pie. It's just like, well,
seems
shit, that makes sense.
Rod, shine.
Shine.
I just love more than anything on this cast recording, like most of the time during that song, mm-hmm. They have, like, Sweeney will say something like, ah, when
yeah.
he gets
what oh,
yeah,
Little
she's
Priest
about.
In the original album is yeah. one of my favorite bits of musical theater because yeah. it is musical and it's also
theater.
Very well, I mean, yeah, it is.
And
because
it's puns.
But that's, it's puns. It's so many bad, good puns. But that's, I think, what I miss so much about, like, I'm not a, like, classics Broadway snob kind of person, but I do feel there's, like, a big thing lacking in a lot of contemporary musical theater.
Yeah.
And that you can write a show that's just meant to sound gorgeous and pretty, and you can go off and do that or play with whatever style that you want to. But it's a damn shame that musical theater is not allowed to feel theatrical, because Little Priest is one of those songs that you can see this conversation in your head. It is so, like, the way that they hit these words and play off of each other as they just keep becoming more, like, overcome with this weird, insane joy in their planning. It's so good. Like,
it absolutely is.
It really is one of those pieces that's like, I don't even have to think of, like, what this production looked like, the recordings. I can see you all. Like, I can see your faces through the words and through the way that there's emphasis, the way that you're playing into that text while yeah. still singing it and while still making it sound really nice. But the characters are coming through just as much.
I just love the fact that while like most of the Sweeneys are like in on it, like eventually, and they're just like, ah, yes, very good. Len Carew, like when she's just like, you catch my drift, he just goes, huh. Like he just heard a fun fact all of a sudden. Like just the specificity with like the affirmation that he makes made me cackle so much while I was driving.
Well, and I think the thing, it's very subtle, and I think this is one of those, like, may or may not be open to debate, again, not knowing music technically, but we hear a little bit more of this in the opening of the next act in God, That's Good. When he is planning with Lovett, he's like, okay, we've got this chair, and we're going to test this. And she's like, yes, yes, okay. And he's like, I'll pound three times, bump, bump, bump. But it doesn't go with the way that they've been doing the patter.
Hmm.
And she does it twice, because that would fit with how they've been doing this. And he insists that she does it three times as well. And it's this fun, like, idea of, like, so he's got the gusto to do this, but perhaps through this whole thing, like, Lovett is usually listed as sort of a clown kind of character.
Yeah.
But my money is on the fact that, like, no, it's her scheming that's keeping this operation running. And especially because, oh, yeah. And we can talk about this later, but, like, he lets his emotions and his just, like, impulse get the better of him. And it kind of ruins the plan, like, twice. That it really is sort of Lovett is the brains behind the operation. So I really yeah. like that Lynn's is this kind of like, I think I get where she's going with this, but I
she
don't
starts telling
know.
Him about like fourth quarter projections for the pie shop, and he's just like, what do I do with these spreadsheets?
I've got to murder this judge.
But it also completely shows the out of sync nature that yes. Sweeney Todd is in. He is not supposed to be here. He's on a revenge mission.
Yeah. Came back from bloody Australia.
Yeah, Miss Lovett is here with plans of how to live and how to survive and thrive in this
how
Victorian
industrial
zone. How she's
going to build her mojo dojo casa house.
Exactly. But Sweeney Todd is here to kill a guy, and that's it. Like, he's not here for anything else after a certain point. He's like, I want to kill a dude. Miss Lovett's like, but what then? And he's like, I don't care. I'm not thinking that too far ahead.
Yeah. He's just like, I want to kill the oldest geezer man in London.
To contrast with String of Pearls, Sondheim rewrote a lot of things, took some things, kept them in, clearly the pie shop and the meat murder. But now we have it that Sweeney Todd and his young wife, they just basically were starting their life together. They had a child. There is a judge in London who fancies Sweeney's wife, ships him off on basically false charges, schleps him off to Australia to see then if he can woo Sweeney's wife. Unsuccessful. So he assaults her instead.
At a party.
Yeah.
Surrounded by other masked people.
But
we're
so
just
Sweeney,
there for the show, honestly.
They
you know?
Really are, which is the honestly more horrifying part. What does he say? There's a hole in the world and a great black pit, and it's full of people that are full of shit. It's London. But no, so he's off in Australia for 15 years, and he comes back. We're not quite sure how he got off Australia, but he comes back on a boat and he's made friends with a young sailor lad named Anthony, who is very keen to just be like, yeah, I'm just stopping in London. I gotta go see the world, go travel. Brings Sweeney back. Apparently he's rescued him from like a shipwreck, found him floating in debris in the ocean. And so they've forged a nice, like, you saved my life. Thank you. Oh, but I wouldn't ever. How could I leave you in such a state? Like, please let me know if you need anything else. Yada, yada. They go off.
How could I not bond with a foreboding man I met in the middle of the
ocean?
Yeah,
yeah. Who's constantly described as his skin was pale and his eye was odd, you know.
How
seems like a nice guy.
Stay pale after being at like sea for at least 3 months.
That's why Anthony was so close with him. He was just like, wow, you have to be from England. You are so pale. Nothing has changed. We've been at sea for so long and you're still
pale.
Yes.
You still look like you haven't seen the sun in years.
You could tell me about England. Right?
I forgot to mention this play, this musical is like dramatic irony. The musical.
Yes. Like Sondheim's favorite thing.
If you want to finish the plot summary there of any of the twists and turns of the other people in Sweeney's life, feel free to do so.
But he wouldn't want us to give it away.
That's the thing. He wouldn't want us to give it away. So I won't say more than that. We'll talk perhaps what's necessary. It's going to happen.
Yeah.
But okay. I'm trying to honor. It's the first song in the show. And he tells us he wouldn't want us to give it away.
That's true. That's true. You got me there.
No, but my favorite thing that I've realized, though, from having done a production is that, like, you can't convince me otherwise that Anthony is not a himbo.
I mean, I feel like I could.
Like, again,
that.
Just sort of go, like, sweet boy, oh, let me help this poor gentleman that clearly, like, seems real sketch. But he's like, yeah, what a nice guy. You're my friend, Mr. Todd.
You know, if it weren't for all the framing of, like, the Joanna song and everything, maybe I'd let you get away with that. But I feel like himbos should aspire to something better than lusting after a girl that they see, like, three stories up that they've never talked to before and just going, that one. I'm going to marry that
but
one.
Also, this is a man who has talked about traveling the world, seeing the rubies of Tibet and the pearls of Spain, and he goes, but there's no place like London. even though it's stinky and sad.
And yeah. He is after a pale woman. We know this because of his conversations with Sweeney Todd. So he is after Joanna. Who else is the palest woman in this show?
The palest, blondest person in all of England.
But yeah, so we have Joanna, who is the ward of Judge Turpin. Again, now that we fast forward 15 years, here's this young woman. Gee, I wonder who her parents are.
Oh, well, that's at least the paternal side is not a spoiler.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Yeah, because Sweeney does come back looking for his daughter Joanna and his wife Lucy. Yeah. To which, when he comes back to the barber shop that used to be over the pie shop, Mrs. Lovett is there waiting. And it's like, customer, worst pies in London. One of the best songs in the show is basically right in the first 15, 10 minutes of it. But yeah, she tells him like, oh yeah, Lucy poisoned herself. She couldn't bear it anymore. And now the judge has your daughter as his ward. Sorry, sucks to suck. And so Sweeney goes, well, now I have to kill him. 100%. I wanted to. I was hoping I'd find Joanna alive and well. But nope, now I've got to kill him.
Which I think makes him much more sympathetic as a character versus hey, I'm a murder man.
Yeah. No, that's the
I'm
thing.
A murder
Sondheim
man with a murder plan.
Sondheim is very good.
I think that's pretty sympathetic, though. You got me. I'm a murder man in Victorian London. Look, I've always been down with Jack the Ripper, Jack the Ripper. What did he want to do? Murder people. What did he do? Murder people. What did he not do? Get caught. That's pretty wrapped.
You gotta
up
get
and
out
done.
There and nice manifest and... your dreams.
Jack the Ripper's just murdering people, and somebody's like, he shouldn't do that. And Ian comes to his defense just like, hey, you're being pretty judgy right now.
Well, why don't you murder him and stop him? You didn't do that, did you?
You didn't do that, did you, Victorian Batman?
Jack the Ripper secretly has like a mood board, inspiration board.
And I'm in the center of it, actually.
Whoa.
Ian's in the center where all of the red string and all of the thumbtacks are. So before I move us along,
yes.
Emo from Melodrama Land.
Yes.
I do want to ask, thematically, you both are good at theater things. Tell me the themes of this show and we can talk about how they might change or not change. Say theater things.
Say theater things about Sweeney
Say
Todd.
Theater things.
Theater things.
Well, I think one of the key things to take away from this is that it is in Sondheim's general style of a patter and loose ensemble sort of work, in that loose ensemble is very, very tight vocally. You've got to hit every note when you need to.
Loose ensemble.
But it gives this sense of a crowd. It gives this sense of an ensemble that isn't cohesive, but at the same time is forced to be cohesive, which is really, really... on par with this sort of Victorian, not quite Victorian, actually. Victorian's the wrong word, because
we're almost there, but not quite.
Industrial?
We're industrial. We're early industrial, because it's set in 1780-something, so the French Revolution.
When Sondheim writes it, he actually sets it in 1846 as a nod to when The Penny Dreadful was first published.
Oh, okay.
So it's dab.
The Penny
dab,
Dreadful
Kaylie.
Takes place... in the late 1700s, early 1800s, Sondheim bumps up that timeline to 1846, 1847.
So we are Victorian, or we're Edwardian still. I don't remember when that change happens, and honestly, I don't care. I'm American German.
Victoria was there a long time. I'm 90% sure we're still Victorian at this point. Yeah.
It's some British ruler, and the
America was dealing with its
ugly.
Own problems in this time, so we kind of forget what was happening in England.
Yeah, all of the problems that are going to lead toward the Civil War are starting now in 1846. So we're getting
Shit's
there.
Going.
We're getting started with that. So we're busy. We don't care about pies. We don't care about sailors and
I'll
judges.
Never refuse a mince pie.
But then also one of the key themes as well is agency, because we get that very, very questionable ending and beginning where, ooh, who is actually in control of Sweeney Todd's actions? Is it this malevolent god that he worships, this dark god that Toby takes up? The end of the play, or is it revenge? Is it the need to kill and consume that is driven by this industrial mechanism of consumption and devouring and eating of people? We could go into Body Without Organs, but no. Y'all haven't done that podcast.
Deleuze and Guattari.
But when you do Deleuze and Guattari, I'll give you a nice little like, hey, here's a quick definition before you start that episode.
Like, I can already tell you that sounds like a Halloween thing with no knowledge of what that thing actually is. That's
what
like
PhD students do during Halloween, just discuss Body Without Organs.
It's a good it is a good Halloween topic. It would not entertain your usual Halloween audience, but
no.
I'm sure there will be people that go, Body Without Organs, that sounds exciting. And then they'll be like, oh, critical theory.
Yeah.
What are we doing here?
No, I do agree with you, though, because for me, I think one of the big ones that was really clear in images of the first production, and I think has kind of been washed away a little bit, and I'm all for theater that is I don't know what the right word I'm looking for is, but we're going to say of the people driven, eat the rich driven. So the
Marxist.
Yeah. the original production, their sort of big like canvas backdrop, like curtain piece before the show starts, was an image of the London, like the English honeycomb class system. Which you might have actually seen this kind of image before without realizing what it is, but looking at the sort of like the social order of things in London, like again, the mid 19th century is very class driven. And I think this show does a really great job commenting on that, because like so much of this is about not only Todd's status as a prisoner on the run, like returned man, he can't like say or do anything to reclaim not only like what he had before being convicted of a crime that he didn't really do anything, not that we know of, though, but we assume that he didn't, but also here is this man on high, the judge just basically gets the authority to do whatever the hell he wants. And there's nobody that really can step in the way to stop him. There's so many people, whether they are or aren't what they seem, some of them are just able to play this system by lying and cheating their way through things. And those who are naive, who are pure, who are just trying to exist, are constantly undermined, and
they're doing their best.
Yeah. And Little Priest, the song where they're being like, let's kill people and bake them into pies, is all about that consumption. It is reclaiming, like, because it's Todd's strategy. It's not just killing on a murder spree. It is very specific people. It is targeting dishonorable men's throats. That is who he is after, is people who, like, everyone deserves to die. Because nobody is a completely good person, but some of these people are real pieces of shit and they get to go first.
How gratifying for once to know that those above will serve those down below.
Right, right. So much of that song harkens to that, like, the industrial era is so much about workers being consumed by the labor that they are forced to do to serve people above them in some form or fashion, whether they are exploited to the point that they are skin and bone, they can't eat, what have you, or in some instances, just the society as itself doesn't provide. You see the state of the patients in Fogg's Asylum. You see the state of this beggar woman who is just scrounging around and constantly mistreated by those around her, just asking for alms because her life has been ruined. And this is sort of, I think, a really fun way to explore that whole, like, oh, when we say eat the rich, we are literally eating the rich. Because clearly some of these people weren't doing anything for their constituents, their community. These are people in power looking to serve themselves. And what do we get to do to them? If they can consume us, we get to consume them.
Yummy, yummy, yummy. I got lawyer in my tummy.
Yeehaw.
And on that note, I'd like to kick it forward a couple of decades. Let me take you to an era where Hot Topic ruled the earth and My Chemical Romance was played loudly on Zunes for all to hear.
Ugh.
I'd love to talk a little bit about the Tim Burton version.
It's priest, have a little priest.
Is it really good?
Sir, it's too good, at least. Then again, they don't commit sins or the flesh, so it's pretty fresh.
Awful lot of fat.
Only where it's at.
Haven't you got poet or something like that?
Now you see, the trouble with poet is how do you know it's deceased? Try the priest.
Oh, Timmy. Timmy, Tim, Tim.
The man hasn't had, like, a bona fide hit in a long time. Mostly because the things that he's making aren't good.
And he's a jackass.
Yes, this is also true. However, between the years of, like, 1980 and 2009,
yeah,
the man had some genuine hits. Yeah. And I think this is one of them. His mid-2000s version stars Johnny Depp as the titular role.
And wait a minute, who do you think would be Mrs. Lovett if it's Johnny Depp as Sweeney Todd?
Let's do a checklist. Is this a Tim Burton movie?
Yes.
Is there a female role?
Yes.
At least one.
Who can we put in that female role?
Johnny Depp, wait, shit.
Damn it. Oh, it's Helena Bonham Carter.
It's Helena Bonham Carter.
There are no other leading ladies in Tim Burton movies in that time frame. It was just like her, my wife.
My wife.
Another scourge of the mid-2000s era. Hey, speaking of which, Sacha Baron Cohen is actually in this version. He plays Signor Pirelli.
That's true. I completely forgot about that.
Yeah. And he's fabulous in it, I'll have you know.
Borat is out here singing about Adolfo Pirelli.
Yep.
Which is actually so good because of the, like, the way that he pretends to be foreigner in so many other roles. It's actually such perfect casting.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, if we're talking about perfect casting, I also need to mention the fact that Judge Turpin is played beautifully by one Alan Rickman.
Rest Chef's kiss, peace, perfect King. Casting. This is the reason that I don't give the Tim Burton movie more shit, is because they brought, like, they brought Alan Rickman, and, like, Johnny Depp does okay with Todd, like, this version of Todd, but God, Alan Rickman in this album is...
He brings just all of the perfect Alan Rickman-ness to it, and I love it. And also that one guy
and that
Harry
one guy
Potter, who's a perfect like beetle shit for brains, like Jack Wagon, whatever the character's, that's what the character's name is.
Oh, yeah, he's just the beetle
for brains, Jack Wagon.
The beetle, or Peter Pettigrew, or the actual actor's name,
beetle dumpling.
I'm sure he's a fine man in real life. Please do not replay this clip if it turns out he's really into tax evasion or anything. Oof.
Also, Amanda Seyfried is Joanna in this movie, and it's this is definitely how you know it's a 2000s movie. Pretty blonde woman. But gotta be Amanda.
Yes.
Sophie and Mamma Mia, Joanna, like...
I want all of your opinions on the aesthetic and tone of this version versus the melodrama of all melodramas.
It's a damn shame that we lose some of the musical theater-ness in the movie. like, in my opinion. I know some people are like, no, I hate musicals that are movies. I kind of am sad that we lose a little bit of that melodrama, because Sweeney Todd works could be melodramatic, or it could be more just opera, depending on how you work it. And I will say, for a man who has gone on record to say, I don't like musicals, to then pick, there's a play version of Sweeney Todd. He picked the musical version and then cast pretty much an entire lead cast of people that are not singers. I have many questions. But outside of those two sort of main points, I do really love the aesthetics of it. And I think that's the main takeaway of this version of Sweeney Todd, is the aesthetics, the world building that they do through this version really do something exciting that sometimes the theatrical version always can't.
I think, alongside Kaylie, I think Tim Burton's aesthetics as a director fit Sweeney Todd a lot. It is really, really exciting to see all of the sort of like chalk and charcoal that that is so Tim Burton play out in this way. But I think, and I'm biased, I think, obviously, because I encountered the film before I encountered the musical in its actual
same
sensation. Hot Topic kid.
Well, but it
me too,
it reads so much more fluidly, because you're getting all of this information from the movie.
Right.
You're being shown these things. You don't have to get other, and honestly, Sondheim sort of repeats himself ad nauseum with the opening sequence, with every story. I remember watching it recently in your production, Kaylie, where I was like, why do you tell us this?
Twice.
We just got that. Like, we just got all of this information. Why are we here?
Which is sometimes like, oh, I love parallelism. I love, like, recurring motifs. I'm like, yes, but you're doing the same song from two different perspectives. And you could do one version and half of that, but you're doing them the same length.
It's good because it shows those characters have different interpretations of those events, which is part of the problem of the play, is that people have different interpretations of events. But for a movie, for a nice tight, I think this would
it's basically a 90 minute
movie, it is like, all right, here you go. Here are the characters. Here's the plot. We're going to kill some people. Bang, bang, bang. All right. Yep. Thank you for visiting.
Thanks for visiting London. Have a good night.
The only real problem with the movie is that you lose City on Fire in its entirety, because that sequence is beautiful and I love it.
No, I can rant about this at the very end, but I do feel like every version we have gone from since Sondheim, we keep like neutering this story a little bit more and more with each interpretation of it, and I'm sick of it.
I have a feeling that's going to come out with great emotion when we get to the third.
I'm biding my time.
but we'll get there. She's like harnessing her power levels. She's building up the rage. I was joking with this episode. It was going to be the first time that Kaylie comes in guns blazing about a topic and she's pissed off about something, where it's just like, oh God, we don't know her power levels.
I'm pissed.
So I think, like, part of why I keep calling this the emo one is not just the era that it came out in.
But it is sad. It's sad boy hours.
It's very much that. I think so much of it is Johnny Depp and Helena Bonham Carter's performances in that, like, Depp does kind of more of the, like, speak-sing in part of this, which is just kind of like, I'm also feeling like I don't want to hit the notes right now. Which is just, like,
you go back
broody.
And listen to that album. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, also, I hate when a movie musical takes its recorded version directly from the like actual sound from the
film.
Yeah,
so they keep some of the like noises in there too.
Because the audio quality is always way lower, that it's just like, ah, oh, come on, man. How does the 70s version sound better than this? I think it's just that like there's so much brooding in this one versus Len Carew is full of feelings.
Yeah. And I think this is a turning point, like clearly because it's that like, well, you either knew there was a book or you knew that Stephen Sondheim made this musical, or you were at least aware that Angela Lansbury, this was like a milestone role for Angela Lansbury. So like those were, if you encountered it that way, then that's what you knew. But now you have two different versions, basically, that are really the most like, oh, this Sweeney Todd? No, this Sweeney Todd, where one is your theater kid drama and sort of intrigue and depth, and the other is the aesthetics of old London mixed with the sort of like that broody, sad emotion, because it is tragedy.
Yeah.
But it becomes passive, I think, in some regards, and less active the way that the theatrical kind of elements lend itself towards.
Mm-hmm. Except for the fact that like part of it has like that POV CGI that it does.
Yeah.
Where it's just like, ah, this was a movie from 2007 and they wanted to show off and it didn't age as well as they wanted it to. But this movie, given its medium, also has a little bit more freedom.
Yes.
With, like location and styling and all that.
Like, I actually remember the Pirelli sequence in the movie.
Yeah.
And I don't think there's a show like other than the one that was in that I really remember that. Because yeah, you do just sort of go, great, where do we put the town? Like, screw it. We'll just put a cart somewhere and just dim the lights on like upstage of the flats, whatever. Here's the town. But like, I remember that sequence because they set everything up so specifically and like handle again with the costuming set and props to make sure you can see what you need to see, see who's important, see who's different, and what's going on between these two characters, not just,
we're
going to have a shave off.
And also shout out to the fact this is something that the movie does so much better than the original musical version. In that duel, when they're like dueling barbers.
The fastest barber in the West.
This is London.
The movie version does not have the tooth pulling sequence that the musical does.
No, we also cut that from ours.
That's good. Because it's not good.
No.
That portion is always super uncomfortable. And I'm just like, you know, addition by subtraction here, fellas. We did it good. And I just want to take like 30 seconds to talk about By the Sea.
Oh, I do. I think this is the one that actually like, no, this wins. Because it's film. You get to play with like inner world like style and design. I love this By the Sea.
Yes. So just in brief, comparatively, how do you think this, what themes do you think this version presents versus the previous version? Does it stick to that same pathway, Ian, or do you think it deviates a little bit from what it focuses on?
I remember this movie being much more interested in, what's a good term for it? The pretense of foreignness, like and Kaylie brought it up earlier with the idea of these people that are wearing masks, these people and places that aren't real.
They're having this ball all in masks.
But it's the, oh, I'm a foreigner. No, you're not. You live here. Oh, I'm new in town. No, you're not. You lived here. Like, everyone.
I'm new in town.
This whole story is about the same group of
I'm
people
gay,
that lived here.
I'm new in town. John Mulaney, what are you doing here?
I'm new.
Hello, my name is Sweeney Todd. I'm a serial killer. No, that's too strong.
That's a little too strong there.
I make pies out of people. No,
no. Keep dialing it down. Keep dialing it back.
Sorry. Go on, Ian.
But it's also so obsessed with, like, dirt in ways that a lot of musicals can't be, because how the hell do you clean up a musical that's obsessed with dirt? But, like, the movie got to be dirty in ways that, like, you can't do on a stage. Here's filth, here's smoke, here's ash, here's the grit.
The
and
beggar
nitty.
Woman is atrociously disgusting in the movie.
Oh, she's,
she's been having a rough time.
But at the same time, you cut out the parts that actually make her dirty. In the musical, she is this, like, slovenly woman who is also trying to, like, get a quick buck from a hand job that she could give somebody. Whereas, like, the movie, she's like, I am a strange foreboding figure.
Yeah, they make her much more
return the slab.
Yeah. They make her the harbinger in the movie more than she is in the musical. Because Ian and I've always been we stand the beggar woman household, that she's the best character in the musical. And I'm also biased because I've played her, but she really is just out here trying to make sense of her own, like, cracked out mind. And whenever we're ready to open the floodgates of things that are wrong, one of my biggest problems is that they play her just as crazy when she's not. She's crazy to everybody else, but what she thinks she's doing makes perfect sense.
it's one of those stories, and there's a whole list of these, especially in horror, where it's like the crazies were right, which I think is always a fun trope.
She does have those moments, like during act two. Joanna, she's the one running around back and forth going, smoke, sign of the devil, something is wrong over there, do you smell that? That shit's fucked up.
Hey, lady, quit snitching.
Toby, throw the old woman out.
Yeah.
Throw that snitch out.
Pretty
snitches
much.
Get stitches.
Pretty much.
So I think this is the proper time to give Kaylie a platform to yell, because...
Yes.
Oh.
Should I mute myself? Should I, like...
No.
We'll just hear that.
My window is
through.
Open, so I will try to be nice and not scream and concern our neighbor.
So, along with many high school versions of this play that have been produced, which I want to make a note of one just in brief, a story that I read about.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about. The razors.
There was a prop malfunction during one reproduction of this musical.
Yep.
Where most of the time, the razors that this production used were actual razors with the safeguards on, and somehow during one of the productions the safeguard got taken off, so some poor high schooler got, like, seriously injured. I don't believe fatal injuries.
No, I
anything.
Don't think it was, but it was a, like, oh no.
It's just, can you imagine being in the audience and being like, damn, they got great special effects here. How much budget did they
that
have?
Actually, if it was just an injury and not, like, a fatal injury, it probably actually would have looked really lame, because it would have just been a trickle of blood instead of what the spurt usually is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or it would have looked, like, even sillier, because you have the spurt going off at the same time that this student is also like, that just peaked. Ooh, I'm so sorry.
That's okay. Some like dad with a camcorder in the audience is like, you're doing great, son. Good.
Oh, God.
But you know what that does mean is that in 20 years, when we get our, like, murder mystery episodes of CSI or something, there will be a version of
Sweeney
a high
Todd.
School production where they're doing Sweeney Todd and the student actually dies. And it'll be a great, like, ooh, who did this? Was it intentional? And it'll be the props master, because it's always the fucking props master whenever you do those episodes.
And the CSI Miami guy will just take a look at it and be like, wow, looks like somebody really cut to the chase. Yeah! Okay, so there's a new version.
Yes.
Of Sweeney Todd on the horizon, which is a big reason why we're talking about this.
Mm-hmm.
And it stars a certain golden voice boy by the name of
Gat Matarazzo. Oh.
Well, him too. But Josh Groban.
These are my friends. See how they glisten. See this one shine. How he smiles in the light. My friend, my faithful friend.
That one Broadway guy your mom likes.
And me.
Excuse you.
Yeah. Yeah. It is no longer just the moms.
Okay, true. That's true.
We're old now.
We all love Josh Groban.
I mean, even I like Josh Groban, at least a little. Like, in part because, like, he was an interlocking guy and was, like, proud of all of the, like, silliness and dorkiness that comes with that.
Amazing.
Where he put out a tweet. While I was going to Interlaken that I found very affirming. That was just like, I'm going to go buy some ice cream at the snack stand and go make out in a practice room. And I was just like, you understand
band kid slash theater kid behavior.
It was really like too powerful of a like one giant summer long mixer.
He really is just one of us.
He just like me for real, for real. So yeah, Josh Groban is cool.
Yeah.
By our judgment,
he is a big theater kid, like really and truly.
And after listening to the songs, I don't think I would have put him in this role.
Yeah.
He has a beautiful voice. He is a wonderfully talented man. This was a choice putting him in this role.
Yeah. So 2 years ago when they said we were going to get a Sweeney Todd revival, I was really excited because this was one of those things that's like, okay, we knew sort of in the wake of Sondheim's passing, we're going to start seeing his stuff more on Broadway, more in this like, hey, we haven't forgot. This is Sondheim. Yeah. Like presence is still felt. And I was sort of thinking we would be getting more like we got Into the Woods last summer. We got Company, I believe, had been going just before with Patti LuPone and.
I gotta interject real quick that for all of like Sondheim's wackiness, he just has a play that's just like six people and they're divorced. There you go.
Right.
That's the play.
Like I again, this man's library ranges from the people like these things to who the hell asked for this, Steven?
<Who knows>?
Me.
I asked for it. I asked for these.
Ian asked for specifically Stephen Colbert, Martha Plimpton, and the list goes on.
I traveled back in time to Stephen Sondheim and said, listen, I need a play about six divorced people now.
Why did that sound like a YouTube title? I traveled back in time to meet Stephen Sondheim.
I traveled back in time to meet Stephen Sondheim and convinced him to make a play about American assassins. Here's what happened.
I said, hey, listen, Steve-o, listen close. Neil Patrick Harris. And he was just like, what the fuck is a Neil
what
Patrick
is that?
Harris? Why does he have three first names?
Wait, this reminds me about assassins who also have three first names.
John Wilkes Booth, Lee Harvey Oswald, Neil Patrick Harris.
It all
makes sense. No, anyway, no, when they announced that we were actually getting Sweeney Todd as a full revival, I was so excited because I hold the divisive Sondheim opinion that I think Into the Woods is his magnum opus. Like, that's the thing that everybody loves. It is a brilliant and insane piece of musical theater. For as much tragedy as it is, it also does try to spin that into a very beautiful message. I think Sweeney Todd and Assassins are two of his best musicals, though. Todd, just because it is absolutely batshit what this man put down on paper and expected people to be able to do on stage.
Yes.
It is a tall order of a show. And so I was really excited to see that that was going to get a full Broadway treatment. We've had a 2013, I think, revival. This was early 2010s, I think. And I am blanking on who all was in this cast now, but you can find the opening of it on YouTube. And it's so good because it starts with this sort of like the actors come out and put books on stands. You think it's going to be a like a concert, a reading. And as the opening ballad keeps going, they start throwing shit and like, and it's becoming very clearly like, oh, this is choreographed. But it becomes this very like, we've started like we're at the Met Opera and now we are tearing everything apart and ripping off our fancy, like the fancy sleeves on our gowns and spray painting things. And like, this is really cool. Different fun direction for Sweeney Todd. And still minimal. Like, again, every production we've been doing, we've gotten more minimalist with Sweeney Todd, which is fair because you're doing a lot. You need a space that transforms. And how do you do that? Well, you don't show it. You just suggest it. But here I was getting my hopes up that we're going to get something a little more like tangible, gritty, something with this revival. We get till we're getting Josh frickin' Groban as the man himself. And Annalee Ashford, I'm like, she's a beautiful voice. I'd love to see if she's going to do this piece, like, as Lovett, as a character actor, though, because that's what Lovett is. She's not necessarily a leading lady. She's a character. And here I was thinking that Broadway producers would answer such pitiful cries from plebeians like me going, please. Please don't just make this a cash grab that you're just going to bank everything on the names of your two leading actors
you just did with
Hugh Jackman and Sutton Foster and The Music Man when you could have made a production that actually spoke to the con men that are running this country and ruining everything. But no, you just did The Music Man with no changes, but just Hugh Jackman and Sutton Foster. Yeah, it's exactly what we got, but with Sweeney Todd.
What? You mean the most capitalist system of theater in the nation is capitalist? I would never have guessed.
Yeah.
This surprise, is a surprise. Shock. Appalling.
Basically, the one thing that I can't stand is that there is always at least one theater in the Broadway circuit that goes, we don't have anything of value other than the money we could spend to get these actors to do this show so that people will come see them. And yep. Then close it down in maybe 6 months to a year if they stick around that long, depending on how long their contract is. Because after that, no one's going to want to come see it. And I was worried that Sweeney was going to fall into that spot, and it did exactly that.
I think my best summation of the recordings, or at least what's come out so far,
because by next week on the 8th, we should be getting the full, and it looks like they're not cutting anything. I need to double check that before I solidly confirm that, but it looks like they're not cutting any songs. They're doing the full show, cast album. Which I'm excited for, but we've gotten 5 snippets of other pieces so far.
I think in total, I listened to about 7 songs on Spotify, which is what they had released on there. And if the Len Carew version is melodrama and the Johnny Depp version is emo, the thing that I thought to myself during the opening was, this sounds like a children's Halloween CD from 2006. There was just something distinct about how clean it was in comparison to how gritty the others were that I was like, this feels age appropriate for a Halloween party in the fourth grade. It was just something about like the way the vocal performances were recorded and mixed and everything.
Yeah.
That it brought me back to like a chilly October afternoon in 2005. That was just like, whoa, we're having a party at school today?
Whoa.
And it's Halloween themed? Wild.
This is crazy.
And as soon as like the first like solo Josh Groban song comes on, I was just like, I feel so calm and nice. His tone sounds exactly how he did like all those religious songs in the mid 2000s. I thought
you
I was
raise
being like
me up.
Yes. That's why I said like it's he's the Broadway guy your mom likes. That's exactly why he like has just such a pleasant tone of voice and everything that I was just like, you're not a serial killer.
He's pleasant. Pleasant.
Exactly. He's so pleasant that it takes away the edge of the character and of like the tone of the story. Like, I don't want to be like overly critical because from an objective perspective, they are good recordings.
Oh, yeah.
In that they're hitting the notes really well and it's good to listen to. But it takes away all of the attitude and all of the, like, all of the edge of, like, the style and the story and everything that I was just like, oh, come on, guys. This feels like a swing and a miss right here. Like, Anna Lee Ashford, from what I've heard, is fine.
Yeah.
She gets a little too hammy at certain points, like in By the Sea. Whenever she wants to be a seagull, she's a fucking seagull. Like, she goes hard on it. Where I was just kind of like, there's, like, slight Harley Quinn vibes to this. Like classic 90s Harley Quinn, where I was just like, she's hamming it a little too hard here. And, like, I have been probably the greatest critic of the sound of Broadway children's voices across the last 10 years or so. It's my crusade. Like, stop Broadway children 2023. It's
crusade
just
against the children.
Crusade against the children. Go to school, punk. But I feel like this is, like, the Toby role is just so much better when it's performed by a child.
Because Toby is not necessarily written to be a child. Toby's just a younger guy, maybe a little dense, and or there might be something else going on with this character mentally, like, depending on how he's written and perceived. But he is not exclusively a child.
But I do feel like it's best when he's played by, like, somebody who's, like, 12 or 13, just with, like, the tone of your voice before your voice changes. I feel like it's just my opinion. I feel like it's better when, like, you have that air of innocence and youth and not a 30-year-old man pretending to be a 15-year-old.
Oh, absolutely. And I think there's room for that. Like, again, I think that just comes down to the, are you letting your actors actually act when they're singing?
Gaten Matarazzo, who most people would recognize from Stranger Things, does pretty good. He's fine in this. It's just that he's probably 5 or 6 years too old to, like, come across as a young kid. Mm-hmm. Like, he definitely comes across as, like, all right, I'm a college kid. Still an adult, but, like, can kind of fake it. Better than, like, most people in, like, most productions of this, but it's still just like, yeah, but it could be better, you know? And not because of any of the performances necessarily, because I think everybody that you bring on for this cast recording does exceptionally well as themselves. I just think they picked almost all the wrong people for all of this. I don't know. Ian, have you gotten to listen to any of these tracks?
I've listened
to TikTok.
I'm definitely on TikTok. It's been going.
It's
on
everywhere.
TikTok. Oh, it's everywhere.
But I think I'm more just latching on to one of the things that you were commenting on, which is the quality of the sound. And I think you run into the serious problem that horror has, especially in this new age of, like, really good definition and really like crystal clear high definition is really useless for horror sometimes.
Yeah,
because it shows the weaknesses. We were watching Alien recently, and it's those moments on a high definition screen where you see the alien, you're like, that's a guy, I see his arms. He's going wow.
Why do you think, like, a good 40% of, like, horror directors are just like, we're going to make a grindhouse. We're going to put a shitty filter over it.
Yeah. Well,
because honestly, I think there is this really deep association we have with the quality of the media has to match the quality of the emotion. And because horror is a bad emotion, nudge, nudge, wink, wink, we don't want to see horror in, like, perfect surround sound, crystal clear, like, wow, I can see everything. Now, is that actually the reason? I don't know. I think part of the reason is really just that, you know, it sounds better, which makes it sound worse because you want it to sound like it's coming from the 80s again. You want it to have Stephen Sondheim's like, oh, there's like a crackle to it. There's a crunch. There's something about the way we're being that given this information.
Industrial whistle that'll scare the bejesus out of you no matter how many times you know it's coming in the track. It'll
like they even
get
do
ya.
That during like fucking Hades Town. I don't know how they perfectly in like the Hades Town recording were like, all right, let's take a train whistle sound from a 45 record.
Blast
from it! 1950.
But there's something about that steam whistle, that industrial like time to go that breaks the sound quality of the recording. It's too loud. It's too much. Where, like, the new track is sort of like, oh, and there's a sound. It's nice. It's like, no, that should scare the shit out of me. I should be washing dishes and drop a dish and go, God,
jump scare. Sondheim jump scare.
God damn it, hurt me, music. Why don't you hurt my ears?
I think on a similar note, because I'm looking at this track list, there is one thing that I see that is glaringly missing to me. And I think it's because, like, again, as we're polishing horror and we're making it less scary and we're just trying to capitalize on the fact that, oh, it's Stephen Sondheim. Oh, it's this musical with a cult following. What is conveniently left out on this list of the track list for this upcoming cast album. And we did cut this from our show, but that's because it was community theater and we didn't want to do this song in front of a bunch of old people in the middle of the summer. That'd be kind of messed up.
It'd be too raunchy.
Mea Culpa is not on this cast recording.
I forgot about that when I was listening to the 1970s version.
I mean, and that's the thing. It gets left out a lot because it's not necessarily a scary song. In a show that involves a man murdering people with a knife and we know they are getting ground up and turned into meat pies, this one song sung by the judge is more sinister, disgusting, and repulsive in some ways than anything we see either happen on stage or suggested, like, that is happening around the scenes with Todd and Lovett.
What's Mea Culpa about? Because our audience might not be audience.
Yeah, no, I was
to
about to say,
song.
So it is, this is the judge's sort of, like, ballad to Joanna. Like, again, she is his ward, she is 16, and
he's known her since she was born.
Yeah, is basically what self-flagellating and singing her praises, so to speak.
Yep.
So, and it. Why do you think maybe that this song
you can
is really important to a musical about revenge for on a like we want to turn that creepy man into a creepy man. The problem, honestly, with it being cut is, well, twofold. One side is very conspiracy and the other side is less so. But we don't want to acknowledge that form of sexual predation that people in power can have. Mm-hmm. And the more conspiracy one is, the people that do that kind of sexual predation don't want their image on the stage.
We'll never know. Because depending on where and when you're doing this show, this is a really uncomfortable song, and it makes sense to cut it. Again, if you're a college, if you're a community theater, like, and also for time's sake, because Sweeney Todd is a long goddamn show. And that was part of the reason that our director went, we are cutting this. This is 6 minutes of Joanna, Joanna, that we already get from two other songs where we're all like, Anthony's pining over her as well. So like, we don't need another one.
Get out of here, old man.
Yeah. But we also miss, at the end of this song, we see one of his cases that's brought to him at a trial, and he basically sends a child to die. So there is no redeeming this character by the end of that song.
They play that well in the movie.
Yes. Like, oh, yeah.
Fucking piece of shit.
You stole a loaf of bread. Basically a Muppet on the witness seat. Like, you're like, that's not a kid. That's a Muppet. Oh,
he doesn't even talk. Like, he doesn't even get to say anything. He just looks sad.
You could replace that boy in that movie with any of the Muppets except Miss Piggy, and it would read exactly the same.
That is factually incorrect, but funny. I also just want to mention that specific moment when we were watching that movie in theater class, like so many moons ago. That was the moment where I just heard other people in the class go, "Oh, fuck this dude."
I mean, as you should. Like, I actually really appreciate that Sondheim is like, I'm giving this man a whole disgusting, raunchy song so that you clearly get that despite the fact that Todd is running around committing mass murder, this man here, this one, there is nothing redeeming here. He is our antagonist through and through. It's a matter of if Todd can be absolved of that, or if he's going to go down this path, what will karmically happen to him as he keeps pursuing this revenge.
Sondheim was not ready for generations these lack of media literacy skills, though.
Yeah.
Because there are people that are like, I don't know if Sweeney Todd was doing anything right. And it's like... I know who. Yeah, of course. What are you talking about? Who are you people?
Look, Sondheim was also not ready for Gen Z being like ready and excited to die.
Yeah.
That they were just like, me next, king. Come get
but
me.
But again,
daddy.
This is why I'm saying you need to capitalize on that. Sweeney Todd's all about eat the rich, because then, yeah, Gen Z will eat this up. Are you kidding me?
Eat.
I do want to know if you have more complaints about Josh Groban.
I don't have complaints against Josh Groban, but I
Sweet
have
baby
complaints
boy.
About this. Again, it's the overarching system of Broadway theater and a commercial market that is not allowed to be artistic first. It has to be a moneymaker first.
Ooh, give me those sound bites. Give me those sound bites. Wake
like,
up the neighborhood.
Like, that's just sort of my problem, because Sweeney Todd is this batshit insane show, and we got the beautiful revival of Into the Woods last summer. We had a really exciting but still like great way to honor and re-showcase Company, which is another sort of like, I'd say that's a medium set. Like, if Into the Woods is a large scale, people know this. I'd say Company's in like the medium to slightly bigger range of people know this show.
Mid.
And we'd also gotten the movie of West Side Story in 2020.
I said that just to piss off Ian.
Was it 2020, 2019? It was when we got the West Side Story new movie. So, like, again, Sondheim's getting his name out there and all these big projects that you're going to throw Sweeney Todd into that mix. I'm like, oh, so we're doing something with this. Because otherwise, why wouldn't you just pick something? Like, Assassins has popped up twice in the last 6 years ish, something like that, and it's only been small scale, like off Broadway, I think. So for Sweeney Todd to be booked for a Broadway space, I'm like, great, what are we doing here? Nothing. We're just selling the image of these actors. We're not doing this story anymore. There've been a lot of slime tutorials of pieces of this show going around as it currently is on Broadway. I know they're currently casting and looking for, I think, either swings and other subs that are going to potentially go out on the national tour whenever that starts. Because I've been seeing those casting calls. But it's very minimal. The coolest thing about this is the way that they've gotten the chair mechanism to work. Like, it's so smooth.
Murder chair.
But it just doesn't offer any amount of character depth. It's so hard to see past the people that are like the main people in the show, like Annalee Ashford, Josh Groban, Gatton Matarazzo. Like, it is so hard to see past them and actually get love it. Anthony, Toby, like, it's not letting them do that, whether that's direction, whether that's producer input, or whether that's just sort of what they're bringing to the table as performers in some ways. Which sucks, because Sweeney Todd is so much about characters as archetypes following through this cycle of a story. This is a, like, story that ends basically, and you could start it over again, and it's not like it is Hades Town, where it's that, oh no, this one is a perfect circle, basically, the way that they write Hades Town. But like what Ian mentioned earlier, the sort of, like, there's the dark and vengeful god, the dark and hungry god of Sweeney Todd. Is this something in the quest of revenge that feels cyclical, like passes along, it keeps going? Archetypes. We're not really getting that so much anymore. We're losing more set and what have you. I think the only thing I've liked about this is how they're incorporating the ensemble to be this kind of like choreographed organism that is actually populating the space a little bit more, rather than just like, we're just Londoners. But like the whole opening sequence, that sort of like choreographed movement, not dance, like it's Sweeney Todd, there's no dancing in Sweeney Todd, but I really like the sort of jerky, zombie-ish, hive mind kind of coordination from all of the ensemble, the people of London watching, sort of questioning what they're hearing or seeing from Todd and Lovett, because that is sort of their whole thing within the Penny Dreadfuls, within String of Pearls, is don't get caught. And what, like, not that it makes sense for people to suddenly just be in their pie shop and start singing, Sweeney wishes the world away, Sweeney sweeping for yesterday. But, like, the idea that there is something omnipresent in and around that space, and if it happens to be shown through the people of London, I think it's exciting. But Beggar Woman is still just played as crazy. There's really not anything exciting that I've seen so far of what they're doing with Anthony and Joanna, other than just being less creepy about how we're sexualizing her. But she's still just girl with blonde hair, her yellow hair, it's hair, like, that's Joanna.
They were just like, damn, is Amanda Seyfried really not available?
Right. But it just makes me so upset that it's so hard to do anything with a show that is that richly weird and creative, because it's expensive, not only for the rights, but to produce and do that show at a regional theater. That's a huge investment, and not nearly enough theaters are either going to want to take the risk on that because that's a niche audience, or are going to be able to spend the money to do that show. And so if Broadway's not going to give us anything more than just a parade of famous people that sing well with Sweeney Todd, I'd throw the whole thing away. How dare you?
You know, that kind of feels like a really good final thought for everything.
No, because I'm not done. Because what I haven't talked about was the fact that I... You wanted me to go on a rampage, I'll go this on a rampage.
True. I put the bull in the china shop and I can't expect her to leave in an orderly and timely fashion.
Oh dear God, my fine china, what have you done, Gibby?
Oh fuck.
No, I was in a production of Sweeney Todd this summer. It was a community theater production with Ghostlight Theater Company up here in Buffalo. And they're all really fantastic people. They have their own theater podcast that I was on, and I got to plug our show on their podcast. So if you like theater things, if you're local to the West New York area, I guess go follow them. But one of the things that I adored that our director came up to us with was this very strong idea of this, the blood is such a like connective piece of everything, that they're, who has blood on their hands and how, in what way? Is it literal? Is it a sense of guilt? What is this? And so the ensemble was all given these red cloaks. They looked very Handmaid's Tale. Like, don't get me wrong. They weren't. It's community theater. I will say there was no budget for this show. So we were flying by the seat of our pants to put set costumes, props, everything together. And I think for only having basically 6 weeks to do that, turned out pretty well, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Nobody died. We got things that looked nice, got things, some things that looked really good, and we figured out how to make a barber chair slide bodies back and make them disappear. And it was actually a lot of people. There were so many things during that show, and I also had a bit as the beggar woman that I pop out of a barrel to scare Anthony during. She's supposed to pop out of garbage. I popped out of a barrel. That was the thing. No matter what our Sweeney was doing, like, God bless Sean, who was handling all of these, like, close hand, like, basically magic tricks of doing the blood for barber shopping, or, like, making sure that bodies got down the chair and back and nobody saw anything. Doing all this. The artistic director of this company kept saying to me, I still can't figure out how you get into the barrel.
Your secret.
And I'm like, I think Sean's doing a lot more impressive things than I am, but thank you.
She did a lot of research playing Donkey Kong Country.
DK. Donkey Kong. But no, just all of us figuring out, like, how do we get this to work? We'll figure something out. And we would. And I thought it worked so well. There was a creative idea of what to do with the ensemble. We were problem solving on the fly. The production value and quality might not have been there, but the show itself, I felt like, both as like, if I were sitting here watching it going like, maybe we would have wanted some stronger vocalists, but it's community theater. That's not a point I'm really ready to judge this on. As far as just the show working, yeah. It's incredible. We had people like gasping in the audience every night at the end when all secrets are sort of revealed, for better or worse, in the maybe not best of times, which was funny.
As Ian chuckles.
I've got a great joke, but I don't know if I'm allowed to reveal that joke because it was my favorite.
Oh yeah,
joke.
He wouldn't want us to give it away.
So spoilers, okay. Alert.
Ian's going to say it anyway. Alert. Sorry, Sweeney Todd.
An hour and 30 minutes into the episode.
Exactly. So, the beggar woman the entire length of the show. I'm a woman! And the audience, oh, that is a woman. A decrepit pile of miserable prostitution in the last seconds while Sweeney Todd holds her in his arms. His wife. No.
We had at least two people on different nights, like, before he could start singing the next part of the song, they were going, that's the wife!
Like, they had no sympathy for her until she was dead in his arms, and then they're like, oh no! No! This is a terrible dress!
I should have respected you more. Crazy beggar woman.
I should have thought that maybe this woman was a real person before this moment. No.
Which again also feeds more into my own like personal like justice for the beggar woman against like all of these productions of Sweeney Todd, because if they play her as crazy, there is no sympathy for her. One, if you're doing her little lullaby that she has before she dies. Because that's sort of the like, oh shit. Oh, wait a minute, is that? And then you don't have time to think about it because she's dead. If you do that, because I know that there have been professional, like, Broadway caliber shows that have cut that part of the show out. And it reveals so much. But if you just play her as crazy, there's no reason to think that, necessarily. There's no connectivity and realization how troubled and how just desperate for help this woman really is. There's no humanizing her in enough shows, which pisses me off. When you're trying to humanize a serial killer, yet you're not going to humanize this poor homeless woman. But all of this to say, it can be done, and with no money and no budget. And it makes me so upset that when you get the opportunity to do this with considerable quality and value, that you're just going to parade the actors, even though you know there is such a following for this show because of Tim Burton, because it's Stephen Sondheim. Like, oh my God. I have a bunch of like 30 and 20 somethings in a summer in a hot, sweaty community theater can figure out how to sell this show to over 1,000 people in 2 weekends. Why? Why isn't Broadway doing more?
I like this angry Kaylie. This is fun. It's so such a good twist of fate.
That came across on mine. That's
power. That's power.
So angry.
I love talking about this, but it is late.
Yes, I don't want to. I've kept us too long. I'm sorry.
And I think that's okay. If we did it for content, I'm sure my neighbors will understand. which is why I've been talking quietly. Hopefully, I don't know. Anyways,
now we're doing the NPR voice.
Yes, hello and welcome to radio that you have to pay for.
No.
Wait.
I thought it was public.
It's
national public radio.
Oh yeah, it is. I should know that.
you really ought to know.
You work in media production.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. I just assume, oh yeah, NPR, those are the guys that make me buy a tote bag. Ah, of course they are. They must need my money.
That's basically like purchasing.
I'm very tired. Can I go to bed now?
No.
Oh, darn. Anyways.
Does anyone else have final thoughts on Sweeney Todd then? I've made my case.
Ian, give me your thoughts, please. I've been up since 5:50 a.m.
Oh, I'm going to keep you up till 5:50 a.m.
You son of a bitch.
We're just going to go, baby. I've got 6 hours of thought.
Ian's going to talk about body without organs.
All this, well, I could, but I will leave that to you at some point.
Please don't.
Sweeney Todd, I really do love this musical. I think there's a really exciting thing in its performance that seeing it in this community theater production that Kaylie was in, compared to just listening to the album, it's so much more exciting when there are people in front of you. And it really is this fact that, like, as a recording, it doesn't do the musical justice, because you're not actually seeing physical bodies dropping in front of you. Like, it's really exciting to watch somebody get stabbed. It really is.
And so, blood flying across the stage.
Like, it reminds you of Artaud. And, like, I was going to even, like, quote A Spurt of Blood. But the very idea that here is this moment of violence that is not physically possible and yet must occur is so cool. And it's so much fun. It's so theater. It's so theater.
It's so very theater.
That's so theater.
Kaylie, would you like to do the outro to this episode, just to zhuzh it up and shake it up? Oh,
yeah. Thank you so much for listening to this episode of the Liberal Artist Podcast. You can find us on the interwebs, the World Wide Web, through social media on Instagram and Twitter, X. I hate that. I hate that we have to call it that. It's stupid.
We don't have to at all. This is our podcast.
Yeah. The bird's not dead. It's Twitter at LibArtistPod. Please tell us what you like about this episode. Leave a little comment on any of our previous posts, or add us. Tell us what you want to hear about next in the coming months. And you can catch us every other Thursday here on Spotify and Apple Podcasts.
And our guest friend right here.
Leave a comment and tell me that you liked me in this episode. That way I feel validated to a larger degree.
Tell Ian to write their dissertation.
Don't tell me that. That'll make me sad. You can catch me on X, on Instagram, and probably other places as ID Horror Plays. And you can see me and my work on New Play Exchange. And if you can't see that because you do have to pay money to see those things, you can also just email me and be like, hey, I want to read a play of yours. And I'll go, which play? You'll go, I don't know what plays you've written. This was a long outro.
It's like playing a gachapon. You don't know what you're going to get.
I'll send you something, then. It'll be fun.
Join us next time, where one of us suspiciously goes missing and there is only a small little pie in their place. Peace.
The Liberal Artists Podcast premieres every other Thursday on your favorite podcasting platform. The show is hosted by Bodhi Opapula, Kaylie Horowitz, and Andy Gibson. You can find the show at LibArtistsPod on Instagram and Twitter. Thanks to White Hot for performing the theme song, Reflect, which can be found on freebeats.io. Now, I'm off to go exploring, and maybe, maybe, just maybe, I'll find a sheep that I can call my own. Good day.
Attend the tale of Gibby's pie.
Attend the tale of Gibby's pie.
Swing your microphone, Gibby. Swing your podcast high.
I knew that I could count on you for this.